We have all met them. They are delightful to spend time with. They have a great sense of humor, an engaging personality, a winning smile, and winsome ways. There's just one problem. They are not Christians. They never pray, never touch the Bible, and possess zero interest in spiritual things. How do we respond to this dilemma? If Jesus is supposed to make us patient, sweet, and kind, what are we going to do with those folks who are already patient, sweet, and kind and have apparently done it without Jesus in their lives? In some cases, they may even be slightly ahead of us on the niceness scale. When we receive Jesus Christ by faith and we're given the gift of eternal life, there are many changes that occur in our lives. They come in two categories, the instantaneous and the gradual. In the instantaneous category are things like forgiveness of sins and a state of perfect justification in the eyes of God. Instantly, we're a child of God. We're forgiven. We receive eternal life. But there are some other benefits and blessings that are of a gradual nature. They do not arrive with a bang, but rather they grow within us over the course of months, years, and decades. And this would include what the Bible calls the fruit of the Spirit. Fruit never explodes into existence. It gradually and slowly grows until it reaches the peak of perfection. And so it is with the character traits of Jesus that are produced in us as we abide in Him. Kindness, faithfulness, self-control, love, gentleness, all these are developed in us over time. Now, nearly every Christian would agree with that, but what about the non-believers who have not even begun the process? They do not possess the indwelling Spirit, and still they manage to show attractive character and winsome personalities. If the sinner does not possess any trace of divine life, how can some seem to be so virtuous and at times demonstrate character that puts many evangelical Christians to shame? There are businessmen who make no profession of Christ whatsoever, and yet they're entirely upright and honest in their dealings. There are some school teachers who've never gone to church in their lives, yet they make a huge positive difference in the lives of their students. Some non-Christians give large amounts of money to help clothe and feed poor children. How can such noble and commendable behavior spring from hearts that are spiritually dead? Well, what we sometimes miss is the influence of genetics. The tendency to be hot-tempered or easygoing, to be jealous or magnanimous, to lean toward generosity or stinginess, the outgoing, friendly personality versus the awkward, withdrawn personality type. All of these are a part of the basic package built mysteriously within our genes. Certainly, environment can also play a role, and bad and good parenting can make a difference as well. But there's no discounting the role of genetics. Now, one positive genetic factor few consider is that we are all, every one of us, born in the image of God. James writes, "With the tongue we bless our God and Father, and with it we curse men who've been made in the likeness of God." He's telling us that every man and woman has been stamped with the imprint of their Creator. This is true even of the sinner. When we see non-Christians demonstrating kindness, acting patiently, showing honesty, and behaving honorably, we're seeing a residue of their Creator that their sinful nature has not yet fully eradicated. No, they do not possess the life of God, but they do possess some genetic memory of the nature of the one who created them. Some individuals show far more of this image than others, for sure, and especially if they were born in homes with kind, responsible, and attentive parents, it is quite possible they will grow up to become highly attractive, respectable, industrious individuals liked by nearly all who know them. This is not because Jesus lives in them. They're simply the product of great genes, a good upbringing, and being made in the image of God. They're likable, they're attractive, they're admirable, but they're lost and they're in serious trouble. The Bible makes it plain that no matter how nice we are, we're not nearly nice enough. The only niceness, the only goodness, the only righteousness God will ever accept is that which is from His Son, Jesus Christ. In some ways, the niceness of the non-Christians is like orange juice. Orange juice contains quite a bit of sugar, and it tastes sweet when you're drinking it with foods that are not sweet. But if you ever eat a really sweet cookie or a large candy bar first and then sip the orange juice, it tastes downright sour and nasty. And so it is when the goodness and the niceness of sinners is contrasted with the perfect righteousness of Jesus Christ. Now, God is a lot tougher to impress than we are. In people that we assume are nearly flawless, God sees the hideous seeds of egotism and self-interest, and He knows that given enough time and opportunity, those seeds will mature and lead to misery, ruin, and depravity. In the sinner, the direction is always downward. Paul tells believers to put off concerning your former conduct the old man which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lusts. Not only is this sinful nature foul, loathsome, and corrupt, it is growing more corrupt. We must have our heart, our nature, our ways, and our direction fundamentally changed. For this reason, Jesus tells us, you must be born again. When we receive Jesus and become members of the family of God, the Holy Spirit immediately begins His process of sanctification in us. He directs our circumstances, our blessings, our challenges, our relationships, our opportunities, and everything else in our lives to work as His tools in forming the character of Jesus Christ in us. Now, it's not an overnight process, but He is patient. Just as with the sinner, He sees the end from the beginning. He knows that the ultimate result is sure and it will be a beautiful thing. Most of us don't look too beautiful in the early going. However, we have all sorts of rough edges that need smoothing and warts that need removing. We may rank fairly low on the sweetness scale, perhaps even lower than our unsaved neighbor. But in the eyes of God, there's a vast difference between us and them. Whereas the Christian is being transformed from glory to glory and moving, albeit somewhat rather slowly, in the direction of the very nature of Jesus Christ, the unsaved man, on the other hand, is growing worse, less patient, more selfish, and more irritable with the passing years. His progress downward may be as imperceptible to others as our progress upward, but in the eyes of the Almighty, the difference is enormous. We who are in Christ are called God's workmanship, and the end result will be beautiful.
Probably most of you know my wife Benedicta, but few of you know the amazing paths God has led her to bring her to where she is today. Benedicta was orphaned at an early age and lived with an elderly stepmother growing to adolescence. They were so poor, Benedicta had to drop out of school and sell food door to door for them to survive. As a teen, Benedicta got a job as a housemaid, which developed into a nightmare. She was required to cook, clean, wash, take care of the children, and she had to get up at 4 a.m. every day just to get her work started. Worse than that, she was frequently beaten. At around 20, she moved to the huge city of Lagos where she started her own little business. Sometimes she prospered, but at other times she nearly starved and went days at a time without eating. At one point, she became so sick she passed out in her room and nearly died. She found herself outside of her body and she was able to see the splendors of heaven until she was sent back with a command to share her story. One day, however, her life changed when an American evangelist came to her community to preach, and of course, that was me. The rest, as they say, is history. Benedicta has shared her life story in a recently published autobiography, and you can get it on Amazon as either an ebook or a paperback. A link to this book on Amazon is in the description.